Hello, hello, everybody. Today we are going to talk about something which might seem very obvious to you, but which is actually a little bit more complex than most people think it is. It is how water moves around in the ocean, and there is basically two big parts to it. The one is the global circulation, and the other one is how water actually goes up and down, and that is on a regular fashion done by the tides, which comes in a separate lecture. Now, to explain how the motion of the ocean works, it will take us quite a lot of steps to work through. It's a reasonably complex mechanism, but I'm going to break it down into little bits. And I ask you to be a little bit patient and stay with me on the journey, because it will all make sense. Well, that's what they always say, in a little while. And the motion of the ocean can be very violent, as in this, depiction here of, bodies being thrown around a rock and some of them climbing up here, tying themselves to themselves. Or it can be relatively predictable, but moving vast amounts of water around the surface of the planet. Now, this is possibly my favorite website at the moment. It's pretty sad as a scientist. And it's basically NASA, whatever you want to call it, having put all their computing power to good use and make the simulation of how water moves around the planet. But there's a massive feature here going up between Florida and Cuba. Very well defined, going all across the Atlantic. That's of course the Gulf Stream. Now, as we come down into the tropic latitudes, in every ocean, we have one of those really, really cool equatorial currents, and some of them are massive. Okay, southern tip of Southern Africa, going up towards Mozambique, and between Madagascar. Look at this strong Agulhas Current jetting down. Here we got the tropical current coming in from the Indian Ocean, butting against the coast of Kenya and going up into Somalia, eventually breaking up here in the Arabian Gulf, or actually going over the subcontinent. Now, this is probably a hellishly complicated area of the world, mostly because there's so many straits, islands, and basically complicated topography. However, look at this feature. Very clearly defined, running all the way up the coast of Japan and eventually going over into the North Pacific. As we come over here, it doesn't look as well defined, but trust me, it is. It's the California Current coming down the coast, the west coast of Canada and the United States. Again, look at this amazingly strong current. It's the tropical basically current moving vast amounts of water from the eastern to the western Pacific, where we are in Australia. Here we got the circumpolar current going around Antarctica. So if you ever intend sailing around the world by yourself, this is probably where you go to have the fastest race. And in Australia, of course, the most prominent feature is the East Australian Current coming down here and jetting off the coast here and actually breaking up into all those little eddies. Some of those eddies can persist for days or weeks and actually trap fish and plankton in it. But this is the really, really big circulation. See, look at this. It's absolutely amazing how well it's defined. So there's hours of fun you can actually have here as an early scientist. Or you do something much simpler and look at cows in the Alps. Swiss cows, Austrian cows, could be German cows, but the Germans have, only a little bit of Alps, really. And Swiss cows are, oddly enough, very relevant to understand how the motion of the ocean works. Why is that? Look at this beast here. The legs facing down the hill are about 4 inches longer than the legs facing up the hill. And why is that? There are certain subpopulations or breeds or you know, groups of cults which you run them. And we used to run cattle up in the high Alps, so I know about that. And those beasts always go around the mountain in the same direction. So essentially, so they don't fall over, one side of the body has longer legs and the other one shorter, so they can actually stand level. But the trick is to think about going round and round and round. Now, you can spend days, weeks on the internet nowadays looking at ocean surface temperature charts. Here you see the Gulf Stream going between Florida and Cuba. Why is that relevant? Well, here is probably the greatest writer of the 20th century, arguably, of course, good old Ernest Hemingway. And the last novel he actually wrote, is fantastic, isn't it, was called Islands in a Stream. Read it. It is fascinating because he goes out and, you know, he was too old for active service. So he bought himself a old fishing boat / prawn trawler and hunted with a very primitive sonar German submarines in the straits here around Cuba. He used to live in Cuba for a while, because for the, you know, marlin fishing and all the rest of it. And it is relevant because the German U-boats patrolling up and down the coast here knew that if they hide under a very well-defined warm water mass, the sonar signals get deflected by differences in temperature, and so they could actually hide. It's quite cool reading here. A lot of, you know, he didn't really know the science, I think, behind it, but he applied it very well. And of course, in Australia, you know, we have a very, very complicated, you know, structure over here and up in the north, but on the east coast, it's fairly well defined, being the East Australian Current coming down the coast here. So, why do we study currents? Well, there's about 6,000 different reasons, and I'm only going to tell you six big ones, you know, which is 2 orders of magnitude lower, and that's good enough. The first one is, essentially, if you want to understand the global climate, you have to understand global, basically, patterns in ocean temperatures and currents. Why is that? It would be very, very difficult to live in tropical latitudes because it would be far too hot. And you could actually not live in Greenland or Iceland because it would be far too cold, were it not for the ocean transferring large, large quantities of heat between the tropics and higher latitudes. So in a sense, the oceans are really the true climate temperature regulators. I think what I have written here, climate conveyor belts, here you go. So essentially our climate and our weather, they are not the same, weather is short-term, climate is long-term, are profoundly influenced by heat transfer done by the ocean. And this, of course, gets much more important as we are marching ingloriously, I should say, on towards destroying our planet through climate change. Tell this to Australian politicians. Well, of a certain party, really, only. Also, we all like to eat fish and we all like to basically have other seafood, and that only can happen if fish and prawns and lobsters grow in the ocean. Now, that depends on the productivity of good old botany of some plants, mostly phytoplankton, of course, and they need nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, silica, iron, blah, 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 the whole lot. And essentially, currents are there to distribute the nutrients around the ocean basins. And we will see how they do that in a very, very particular fashion. That also means that if you want to draw maps of organisms, quite often you find that they correspond to certain current features, because currents just particularly for small ones, small organisms, they redistribute marine life across the globe. Now, we just had a ship stuck in the Suez Canal. However, if you don't actually dig through the desert, Moses just went through and parted the waters, much easier for him, of course. He didn't have to dig a big channel. I actually heard like one passage of a big container ship costs $300,000 in shipping tolls. So no wonder the Egyptians were very interested in keeping this thing open. And also, let's not forget, humans have spread around the world, and that spread called exploration of the uncharted territories around the world was only possible by figuring out how to sail ships in favorable currents. So lots of reasons to understand how ocean currents work. Now, if you actually think what makes water work, move in the ocean, there's three different types of what we call primary forces. Now, primary forces are the ones which kick off the initial velocity and direction. In other words, they are physical processes that supply the initial energy input to water masses to get going. The first one is when wind blows over water, it actually transfers part of its kinetic energy to kinetic energy of the water, and that is actually done via friction. So this is my ocean here, and wind blows along, you can actually blow into a water glass or something like this. Basically, I can actually move, I can make little waves, and that's exactly the same principle. I just basically blow a bit, part of my air movement will actually rub on the surface of the water and get the water molecules moving. As I've already briefly mentioned, water expands in the tropical latitudes and it contracts near the poles, and that uneven solar insulation results in water moving because we can't actually have a big bulge around tropics that actually evens out over time, but wait for a little bit. And then we also have a type of ocean circulation which is driven by gravity. And what actually happens there is that when water becomes very cold, it becomes very dense. And it can become super dense when it's super cold, like near Antarctica, and it rushes down to the bottom of the ocean. And of course, that gets replaced. So that really, really huge global scale vertical movement is actually driven by density differences of water masses, and gravity basically acts upon them. Now, a little bit more on weird things, and you might actually say, well, I know about gravity, I know about friction, I know about the shape of the ocean. All of them are bound to influence how water moves. But there's a third force, and that's actually the most important one here, called the Coriolis force. And that has to do with deflection due to angular velocity of bodies on the planet Earth. And we get to that in a second. So once the primary forces have transferred their energy in whichever form, be it thermal expansion, being gravity, being wind, then the actual shape of the movement, I should say, depends on those four secondary forces. They mold the currents, so to speak, in a global ocean. Now, all students, or many students, work in hospitality, and if you're unfortunate enough, you know, to work in a bar where they have very complicated cocktails, you might actually be at rush hour, be asked to actually make about five really weird ones, and some cocktails have a distinctive layering. And you actually achieve that layering by having the coldest liquids at the bottom, or the most warmest, or the the warmest ones at the top, and basically pouring it in very, very carefully. Now, what's the time? 11, too early for a cocktail. But let's think about it would be 5. I should really have a cocktail here. Then essentially, we can think of the ocean as a layered cocktail. What many people don't really realize is that the oceans are predictably structured in terms of vertical layering of properties. They're usually warmer at the top. They also have usually less saline water, so the salt content is lower because of river inflows and glacier melting. And that actually results that usually the surface layers are less dense than the bottom layers. And there is an area of rapid change where basically temperature all of a sudden like drops or salinity goes up. And those two determine the density or the weight of water, if you want. And because those changes are so pronounced, when they affect a temperature, we call that area of rapid change the thermocline. If they affect salinity, salt content, halos is the word for salt increase, then it's the halocline. And if they refer to changes in density as a result of changes in temperature and salinity, it's the picnocline. And it's always quite amazing, you know, and I fell into it. When you go out to and do some, you know, deep sea work, quite often, you know, you have standard equipment like temperature sensors, salinity sensors, oxygen sensors, and so forth. And then you might be actually in the tropics, and that's what happened to me. First cruise out of Fiji on a French boat, or terribly exciting, you know. Here is my, you know, true introduction to deep sea science. And it's nice and warm, and the instrument goes down, and all of a sudden it goes up, whoop, or the other sensor goes bling, and everybody starts tapping on the glass or on the electronic reader as if this would actually make a difference. But that's what we do, you know. Men kick tires when they buy a car, or, you know, look at the cars, they look under the bonnet and everyone goes like, yeah, right. But we also tap on things when we actually think a needle is stuck. But of course, that's all maybe in the old days that actually worked. I should actually show you the readout on my Land Rover. Everything goes like this, but it's from 1957, so it doesn't really matter. And those changes are real. They happen in a very narrow band called the thermocline, the halocline, and the combination of these two is the picnocline. And that is important because we distinguish two major types of currents when it comes to circulation. And they're called shallow versus deep. And the shallow circulation happens above the picnocline, basically, you know, plus minus 400 meters. It's a little bit shallower in the tropics, a little bit deeper in temperate areas, but it doesn't really matter. So think about the top layer of the cocktail, which you can slurp off. And basically, yes, it's geographically vast, okay? But it's only 10% of the ocean water, because the oceans are, as we have seen, on average about 4,000 meters deep. Now those currents are mostly driven by wind friction. And surface currents are the big, big horizontal water mass movements, which are so important for the distribution of organism, heat transfer, shipping, and our basically civilizations in coastal areas. And the primary force acting on this is wind and thermal expansion of surface waters. And of course, the deep currents, which we're going to deal with towards the end of the lecture, are exactly the reverse. They happen below the picnocline, but they also have one thing different to the surface currents. There is an enormous vertical movement done by gravity acting on water masses. What most people don't realize, there's parts of the ocean where literally gigaliters per second rush down in gigantic internal waterfalls, only to actually creep throughout the oceans and then slowly come up again. And because gravity acts on the weight of water, differences in density or weight, you know, essentially are caused by temperature differences, which basically means colder water is denser, it sinks, and differences in the salt content. The more salt you have in a water body, the heavier it is. And so the combination of variation in temperature and salt content means it's a thermohaline circulation. Thermos referring to temperature, halos referring to salt. I know there's a lot of distinctions here, so you need to probably pause on those frames a little bit and go back to your lecture notes. But essentially, we need to get those distinctions right in the beginning. Otherwise, we're just going to lose ourselves in a gigantic tangle of different terminology. Now, back to the Swiss or Austrian cows. Right, let's go back to the Swiss cows. As you remember, I told you about 6 minutes ago that they go round and round and round the hill their entire life, always in the same direction, which basically is kind of problematic because you don't really want to topple down the mountain. So you can actually see those two beasts here. They made themselves little terraces. There's probably a cow for each of those going around. And they have longer legs on one side. Now, what has this got to do with oceanography? This is my favorite image of the oceans. What it actually shows is that we have all been tricked in primary school. When the teacher told us and says, oh, you know what? The ocean is flat because we measure everything on land relative to mean sea level. Well, obviously, that's not quite true because this image actually shows us that we have gigantic hills in the ocean basins, the size almost of Australia. There is one up here, there is one here, there is one here, there is one here, and there is one here. In every major ocean basin, in the North Pacific, South Pacific, North Atlantic, South Atlantic, in the Indian Ocean, in the Himalayas, we can't have a hill because they're quite big hills by themselves and there's not much liquid water there. And those hills are even offset towards the western part of each ocean basin in each of the major oceans. So what the hell is going on here? Well, let's think about the going around and round bit again. That's a recurring theme. You've got a carousel here, and here is something you might actually buy, you know, when you stumble out of an Irish pub at 2 o'clock in the morning. It's here we go, and this is a gyros, and gyros is the Greek word for spinning around and around and around. Now, we call them in Australia kebabs, but the Greek term for them is gyros. And we will actually meet that particular term in a very short little while. Now, what has that got to do with ocean currents? Well, it has got a lot to do because in each ocean basin, we have a little kebab machine. No, we don't really, but the the word is here, a chaya. And chaya are gigantic water masses going around in a circular fashion. We have one, surprise, surprise, in the North Atlantic, it's called the North Atlantic Chaya. In the South Atlantic, it's called the South Atlantic Chaya, the Indian Ocean Chaya, the North Pacific one, and the South Pacific ones, we are sort of here. Surprise, surprise. But isn't that kind of odd that it's actually so predictable? It's even more odder when you come to think about how would something like this, you know, I sit in the subtropics, and as I've told you, they are in each ocean basin. But what is really, really remarkable is that they have a predictable direction of movement. They spin to the right in the northern hemisphere, and they spin to the left in the southern hemisphere. And they go several hundred meters deep. They span entire thousands of kilometers shores from west to east. And the question now arises, why do they spin and what makes them spin so predictable? And here we go again. What this one actually shows, this is what I quite like, is the chayas, they transport warm waters from the tropics, either down here or up there like the Gulf Stream or the Brazil Current or the Indian Ocean Current. But they also bring cold water up from polar latitudes towards the tropics on some coasts. So they both have a warm water and a cold water component. Again, very predictable. Now, to understand all of that, we have to observe something quite peculiar. And that is, imagine there is wind blowing straight down a body of water. You would expect, as the energy is being transferred from the kinetic energy of the air molecules to the kinetic energy of the water molecules, that the water mass would actually go ahead in a straight line. But what actually happens is it veers off. It veers off to the right in the northern hemisphere, and it actually buggers off to the left in the southern hemisphere. And it does so in a very, very predictable way. Now, very, very odd, isn't it? Now, how does this actually work? And the trick is to understand the Coriolis force. Now, listen to this explanation, which is actually probably better than I could.
If you've ever watched the news during a hurricane or wintertime nor'easter, you've probably noticed that big storms spin over time as they travel. In the northern hemisphere, they spin counterclockwise. But if you were watching a storm in the southern hemisphere, you'd see it spinning clockwise. Why do storms spin in different directions depending on their location? And why do they spin in the first place? A storm's rotation is due to something called the Coriolis effect, which is a phenomenon that causes fluids like water and air to curve as they travel across or above Earth's surface. Here's the basic idea. Earth is constantly spinning around its axis from west to east. But because Earth is a sphere and wider in the middle, points on the equator are actually spinning faster around the axis than points near the poles. So imagine you were standing in Texas and had a magic paper airplane that could travel hundreds of miles.
Of course, that must be a very big plane because it comes from Texas.
You might think it would land straight north, maybe somewhere in Nebraska. But Texas is actually spinning around Earth's axis faster than Nebraska is, because it's closer to the equator. That means that the paper airplane is spinning faster as well. And when you throw it, that spinning momentum is conserved. So if you threw your paper airplane in a straight line toward the north, it would land somewhere to the right of Nebraska, maybe in Delaware. So from your point of view in Texas, the plane would have taken a curved path to the right. The opposite would happen in the southern hemisphere. An object traveling from the equator to the south would get deflected to the left. So what does this have to do with hurricane spinning? Well, at the center of every hurricane is an area of very low pressure. As a result, the high pressure air surrounding the center, or eye.
What we have here is the change in direction, the deflection of direction of a water mass being transported by wind is due to the Coriolis effect. And that Coriolis effect is basically a consequence of every object on Earth having an angular velocity, which is caused by us spinning, you know, rapidly at, around our own axis, and a linear velocity. And we carry that angular velocity with us. So if you go basically as an object into a different part in terms of latitude, that greater angular velocity will actually lead to a deflection. And that's actually a very, very real phenomenon. Now, you can actually now take this to the extreme, and this is what actually happens in big water mass movement. And that is, layers below the surface have to be brought into motion by frictional transfer of energy. So as you go deeper, the currents become weaker because there's frictional heat losses. But every time a new layer is being set into motion, it gets deflected by the Coriolis force progressively as you go down. That basically means that you reach a point where at the bottom of that water column called an Ekman column, after the Norwegian oceanographer who discovered it, the water actually flows in the opposite direction to where the wind was blowing. And here we actually see all of that in a different graphic display. However, what it actually comes down to is that the average flow is at a right angle to the original direction of the wind blowing. Remember that. Now, we have dealt now with the Coriolis force. We know there are hills, but we haven't quite understood why there are hills. And for that, we need to actually examine what the major wind patterns are on the surface of our planet. And it is really, really remarkable how consistent these wind patterns are. So we have, diagrammatically speaking here, in this diagram, we got a band from the tropics to the subtropics, which is called here the northeast trade winds and here the southeast trade winds. They are named after basically the trading ships of the British East India Company and Dutch East India Company, exploiting, and the Spaniards then as well, exploiting that knowledge to go between basically the European bases and various colonies which they raped and pillaged. Not a very, very nice part of history to be, you know, to use a very, very overused adjective. It's actually a horrible part of history, like a frighteningly awful part of history, but let's not get started on that. And then we have a band of westerlies, wind blowing from the west in each hemisphere, and then we got the polar easterlies. Now, to understand why we actually get ocean masses spinning around and around and around, we need to understand that those wind patterns are, in the long term, always more or less like that. And, you know, you can have a diagram like this or like that. But even cooler is the fact that we can actually check out the wind pattern is like today on a global scale. There is actually a very, very cool website. Here we go. Called windy.com. I'm sure for those of you who go kite surfing or sailing will have actually accessed that. And it's a veritable treasure trove because not only can you examine whether the textbooks are right, but you actually get very, very good predictions, you know, on a course scale, of course, for every point on Earth. I always wonder why it actually goes back to the issue. Never mind. Let's see what we have here. So, surprise, surprise, we got a southeasterly, which is, of course, the one, you know, which we always have. But as I actually go out and have a look into the Pacific. Okay, now we have this actually big pressure system here. But what is actually remarkable is that you can, on most days, observe very consistent wind patterns. What did I just tell you about the trade winds? Let's see if we get the westerlies as well. Go a little bit further up, I think. Here we go. Here we got the westerlies. Fantastic. And you can already see it's actually flowing around. How on earth does it actually flow around? What actually causes that? Well, let's go back to Coriolis force. We have the trade winds, the northeasterly ones and the southeasterly ones in the subtropical band. Now, think about the deflection caused by Ekman transport at a right angle away from the direction of the wind. So what you basically get here is you get a net movement of water in the trade zones, which goes to the northwest in the northern subtropical zone and to the southwest. Those are those areas here. Consistently so, right? Now we go over. I'm being replaced by the wind thing. Now we go over to the westerly wind band, which sits in terms of latitude above the subtropics. And again, when we account for Coriolis deflection down the water column resulting in Ekman transport, which is to the right in the northern hemisphere and to the left in the southern hemisphere, you get those kind of net movements. So again, you get something which you can see is starting to complete that circle. Now, here is a static diagram, but we can actually go one better. And again, I love those visualizations from NASA. If you actually start this going, you can actually see here we got a big equatorial current. And as it comes down, it goes down there, and we go into the circumpolar current caused by the westerlies, and then it comes up. It goes like this, it comes up, and it goes down. It goes around, it goes like that. And it goes like that. Here, of course, you got this massive wind in the wind band in the roaring 40s and the screaming 50s. But what you can see from these visualizations, this is very, very real. And it all has to do with predictable wind bands, which I actually called by warm air rising in the tropics, then it actually goes down and it cools down, it comes down in the subtropics, and then it actually flows back to the equator or up, and that causes the westerlies and the trade winds. It's all about uneven solar insulation. Now, everybody should know where east and west is, and you might say, why am I going to actually explain to you guys now? Here we have a continent, and you've got a west coast down here, and an east coast. Here's Australia, we've got a west coast, and we've got an east coast. Here is North America, we've got a west coast, we've got an east coast. We got a west coast and we got an east coast. What has got that to do with understanding ocean currents? Well, remember, we are oceanographers here mentally, even though we sit on dry land. But, you know, we are talking about the ocean, not so much about the land. So for an oceanographer, essentially those bits of, you know, crustal rock are actually annoying. The dry land is very, very annoying. Now, what it basically means is we have to take a reference point from the perspective of the ocean basin. So the ocean basin has a western boundary and it got an eastern boundary. But the western boundary, of course, sits off the east coast of the continents, and the eastern boundary of the ocean basin sits off the west coast. This is actually a lovely chart. I put it up on Blackboard. You can actually download that in high resolution. It's basically a large scale from the 50s planning chart for taking basically a sailboat across the Pacific. And all these ocean currents are actually drawn in. And remember, when I told you about shipping, same thing as sailing, of course, that they are saying everything else being, you know, taken out in terms of the small scale weather variation, we get those persistent currents. Here's the westerly one going over, here's coming down, going around the tropics again, and so forth. And the same for the South Pacific. I mean, look at this chart. It is fantastic if you look actually at the details, because it takes away all that variability which actually comes from having weather systems, and it really focuses on what you can actually feel in terms of the major transport as a sailor on a little ship. And again, think about the western boundaries of the ocean basins off the east coast and the eastern boundaries off the west coast. Now, why is this important? Look at the direction of current flow. A western boundary current will actually go from the tropics down towards higher latitudes. And by contrast, an eastern boundary current goes from higher latitudes towards the tropics. So western boundary currents bring warm water down the coast. Eastern boundary currents bring cold water up the coast. And there are other major differences between those two current types. Because the Earth spins from the east to the west, it actually pushes the currents towards the continental margins here, and they literally get compressed. That means western boundary currents are usually narrow and deep, and they run really fast, up to 100 kilometers a day, because they get actually concentrated or compressed literally by the momentum, spinning momentum of the Earth. But what is much more important is they are nutrient poor. They carry surface water which has traveled a long way across the Pacific here without any literal or significant access to land-derived nutrients or deep water. And so that water basically has been depleted by nutrients. All the little phytoplanktons over 1,000 kilometers have more or less gobbled all the free inorganic nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, and so forth. So they are nutrient poor. Those ones here, the eastern boundary currents, by comparison, are nutrient rich. This is where all the action happens in terms of productivity. That action is so pronounced and so concentrated in those eastern boundary currents that chances are whenever you eat anchovies or sardines, they will have come from one of those major eastern boundary current systems. Here we go, we got a couple of sardines, much undervalued as a fresh fish, I think. And you might have read on the previous slide here a curious term called upwelling. What is upwelling? Well, on the west coast where eastern boundary currents flow, quite often you have wind systems which either blow straight offshore and hence then push water away, or they run along shore and because of Ekman transport also move surface water from the nearshore ocean out into the pelagic zone, into the oceanic realms hundreds of kilometers away. Now, what actually happens in reality then is that that warmer surface water moves offshore. Now, the ocean, you know, along west coast does not have a gigantic trough near the shore. You can surf perfectly fine in Chile. Oh, it's a bit chilly there. Huh? Or in California. And that water, which actually gets blown offshore literally, is being replaced by deep water coming up from the abyss. And that is a fantastic thing when you look for productivity, because as organisms die and sink through the water column and basically land up on the deep sea floor as organic particles, they will disintegrate, they will decompose by bacterial and viral action, and that sets free the very elemental constituents of every living body, being nitrogen, being phosphorus, iron, silica, and so forth. Now, if you then have a mechanism like upwelling, which can bring those cold, deep waters to the surface again, it will carry, it will introduce to the sunlit layers a fertilizer. That deep water is fantastic because essentially it's like a compost from your garden. However, it actually is useless in terms of productivity, primary productivity, while it sits at the bottom of the ocean because it's too cold and too dark. Plants need light. Phytoplankton are simple little plant cells, and they have the same fundamental photosynthetic requirements. So you bring cold water with lots of nutrients, and the moment it actually hits the sunlit layers, 200 meters or something like this above, ta-da, productivity goes bananas. And this is why, along the west coast of continents, you often have fog because of the cold water, but you also have enormously rich fisheries for small pelagic fish, such as sardines, herrings, and anchovies. And this kind of scenes are common in west coast communities relying on fishing, but not so much actually on the east coast where the tropical warm water comes down. So if you think about productivity fisheries, it's eastern boundary currents. Yum, yum. Now, where are those major eastern boundary currents located? I'll just give you some examples so you can see I'm not just, you know, making this up from lots of fancy scanned images, you know, somebody sketched. Mark Twain said the coldest winter I ever spent was a summer in San Francisco. Now, he was a very peculiar character, but what did he mean? Essentially, San Francisco, here you go, fantastic place to go. Here's the Golden Gate Bridge, sits off the California Current. Now, the California Current is an eastern boundary current, which transports cold Arctic water down the coast here. And that actually is fantastic for productivity. You've got fantastic kelp forests in Northern California and in Oregon and Washington, as well as the sea otters are. It's a great place. And actually diving, if you can actually stand the temperature in that kelp, is also quite an experience. And you can see this cold water coming down here. Another one is here, the Canary Islands. Angled for a project there, but COVID has interfered here, but we will try again. You're ready to go. And the Canary Islands sit, of course, in a current called, ta-da, the Canary Current. I must show you something like this, which is very interesting. It's volcanic islands. You see the dark volcanic soils, fantastically rich in nutrients, but because it's an eastern boundary current, you can have cold fog and cold wind coming in from the sea. So every vine here is protected. See the little windbreak? It's fantastic. And they sit in these little hollows, soaking up the sun, and essentially the sun rays reflect from the black surrounds. So it's like a little mini greenhouse with a wind shelter. And of course, everything is harvested by hand. An enormously ancient practice to actually grow wine just goes to show, like, wherever we are as humans, we're just always desperate to make alcohol. But it's some really unique viticultural practice. And, you know, it's nice to have those old traditions carrying on. And, of course, further down the coast, further in from the coast, this Mauritanian fisherman. And, of course, the coast goes down, Mauritania, Senegal, Chad, all that kind of stuff. And they go out in these colorful boats to catch sardines because they are in the Canary Current. You can actually see once it actually starts as it comes down here. Now, this is the northern coast of Namibia. Again, we have to go and sample some beach scavengers there once we actually all got, hopefully, the vaccine. And that sits right on the Benguela Current. The land ecosystems there have very, very low productivity, but the sea is booming with life again because of that cold current and the upwelled water being very, very rich in nutrients. Finally, we go to some of the warmer ones, of course. One of the best examples of the Western Boundary Currents sits between Cuba and Florida, and that's the Gulf Stream. And of course, the Gulf Stream is probably, in terms of climate regulations, the best researched system currently in the world. And there's a very, very good reason for that. And that is, it transports such massive amounts of heat from the Atlantic up the eastern seaboard all the way to Canada and then over to the other side to UK and Northern Europe, that many of those areas, like particularly, you know, the ones at higher latitudes, would be affected by climate changes and weather changes, which are more stormy, but also which will be significantly, potentially colder if something catastrophic would happen, as the Gulf Stream potentially very much weakening or even coming to a stop. Now, those are scenarios which are being considered under climate change. There is, of course, huge debate of whether this is likely or whether not, but this actually goes to show what I told you early on, that those ocean currents really determine where we can live as humanity with some sort of reasonable climatic dignity. It all has to do with transferring heat between different latitudes across the planet. Now, here is Cape Town. This is, you know, Table Mountain, the universities are around the corner here, Lion's Head and so forth, which sits just above the Cape of Good Hope, which is down here. And of course, it is at a coast which is influenced by an eastern boundary current running all the way down from the tropical Indian Ocean via Tanzania, Mozambique, Madagascar, and eventually then going out into very spectacular eddies and swirling water bodies. Now, again, this is very different because it's warm water coming down a continent. The Gulf Stream takes warm water up around the east coast of North America, whereas the Benguela Current, the Agulhas Current, takes warm water down. Now, this is quite a fanciful shed. I think they keep the lawnmowers and whippersnippers for their botanic garden there in Sydney, something like that. And of course, on the east coast of Australia, you know, if you ever have kids, or you had kids, you probably know about that painful experience. Please do yourself a favor and never, ever, ever, never, ever buy the DVD of, you know, Finding Nemo, or if you download it, just say the file is broken or whatever, because, you know, that turtle actually swims down with her friend, and it's all about, you know, riding the East Australian Current and all that kind of stuff. So you probably know more about the East Australian Current than you wish you would have ever known. But what it basically does, as you can see here, warm water actually comes down our coast. And that basically means, yes, we have some fisheries, but in comparison, in a global comparison, they're very small, they're very insignificant, they don't actually do terribly much. So we know about the East Australian Current because, you know, you can go swimming in Mooloolaba in the middle of winter. It's fantastic because it's all that warm water which we receive, because we've got a great climate in Queensland, unless, you know, the Mexicans fell down in Victoria. But a significant contributor to that ocean heat is tropical water being transported down the coast. Quite often we get quite spectacular eddies being, you know, cast off towards the coast. And it actually also is fairly close to the continent. You can actually go out, you know, on a reasonable boat, and within an hour, you're often quite, you know, you're in that current. The water is a lot bluer. But bright blue water actually is nice if you're a tourist on a South Pacific island. But if you actually are after fisheries, you want murky green water full of algae. But this is a western boundary current, so it doesn't have the same productivity enhancement as an eastern one has in combination with upwelling. So I told you about shallow currents now, and let's sort of think about going a little bit deeper. I don't know where this slide comes from, who makes, you know, stuff like this. It's very outrageous. Now, the second type of circulation is one which involves great vertical movement of stupendously large water masses. It is a truly global phenomenon, and it is not pushed along horizontally, primarily by wind and then deflected so we get the Swiss cows running around the hills. It is one which is driven by differences in the weight mass or density, you know, of water masses. And that density difference is created by changes in the temperature or the salt content. Cold water is heavy, warm water is light. Water with lots of salt in it, saline water, is heavy. Water with fewer salt molecules in it is lighter. So once you actually have differences then in how warm or cold a water mass is and how much salt it contains, you get differences in density. Now, the most pronounced one of those occur near the Arctic land masses and near Antarctica. And what actually happens in those polar regions is, in a few areas around the world where there's usually not a lot of wind, but it actually is consistently cold, water becomes super cold, like 2 or 3 degrees. And it becomes so cold that it basically rushes down the continental margin as an Antarctic or an Arctic bottom water mass, because it is so cold. It is much colder than the surface waters, say, than basically the waters next to it. So that has to be replaced. And throughout the oceans, I love this sort of cross-sectional diagram here, it actually slowly creeps up again. And that actually forms the thermocline. Remember what I told you about the cocktail? It's basically the cold water slowly coming up and some energy warming up the top layer. So the difference between the top layer and the bottom one is, this is the cold water coming down and this is the warm water being heated up. Now, some of that warm water then actually is flowing back towards the polar regions and then getting very, very cold and sinking again. And that kind of mechanism, that general mechanism, drives the global circulation, the thermohaline circulation. Lots of diagrams can be found about that. This is a cross section of the Atlantic between Antarctica here, the Arctic area, and you can actually see this really, you know, dense Antarctic bottom water. And this is the North Atlantic deep water, which comes from Greenland and Iceland. Both of them go up again, then it flows this way and that way, and that actually completes it all again. Really quite fascinating stuff if you think about it. And this is actually quite real. This is a temperature cross section between, it runs up the Pacific, and this I think is Tahiti, and what you can see, it comes down from the Antarctica, very, very cold, and it actually creeps along and then slowly gets up again. Of course, because this is, you know, all solar radiation. And this is actually, you know, you can get live casts of those, you know, from NOAA. Displays very, very nicely the very, very strong density stratification we have in the oceans. Here's a model, and basically what actually happens is that deep circulation connects every part of the ocean. I quite like that one, which actually shows you where stuff goes. It flows on the surface towards the polar region there, but then actually observe it as it cools, and it's really cold in Iceland and Greenland, we know that, it becomes denser, cold water is dense, and then it actually sinks. And then it will actually go all the way through the Atlantic. The same process happens down in Antarctica, and that basically is one of the mechanisms which connects every part of the ocean on Earth. Now this is quite interesting because people say, like, oh, you know, you might do a little bit of, you know, a disposal. This is actually the politically correct term. Basically, we dump some really toxic waste, particularly nuclear waste, somewhere in the deep ocean because it will actually, you know, not be disturbed there and will actually stay there. Well, if something does go wrong, you know, every oceanographer can assure those nuclear waste managers it will be everywhere. So the notion that we can somehow isolate one part of the global ocean from others by geographic compartmentalizing it in our brains is complete rubbish, because it is this deep circulation which connects every singular bit of the ocean with the others. And I think this is actually something which you should reflect upon when you actually, when we actually think about global phenomena. Quite often you think like, what's actually the process for that? Here we've got to actually a very, very clear one, which is well understood and well measured. And that's the language of ocean circulation, which is, of course, something, you know, you can learn from a book. Why doesn't it work? Come on. Now we got about 5 versions of it loading up. Right, here we go. Well, not. Finally. So the language of the ocean is basically on a global scale, see, one of circulation.
Well, I learned it from a book. Hello, I am English. Hello. How are you?
I see you for